what that really meant, and about 15 of us actually went to Counselor Wade after. And I just want to make sure that I understand where that motion was. And this is what I understand happened, that the green fees have been organized for the 2012-2013 year, but also that I was told, as well as 15 people, if I'm correct, that there will be a public consultation process set up. Still waiting for time, still waiting how that's going to happen, with everything on the table. So I just want to make sure that I'm not telling people that anything's wrong. Like I said, we all went up there after because nobody knew what was going on, and this is what I remember being told. So am I correct with that? And I'm just putting that out to the council. So we as a community and the neighborhood and everybody concerned knows we're just waiting for that call.
Sorry, I didn't hear a response to Margaret's question. Is there going to be a public consultation? As to why the golf course is the only recreation center part that is supposed to be self-sustaining. Okay. That's one of my questions. And also, if it is going to be self-sustaining, I'd like to know why the revenues from the past, the profits from the past, were not put into reserve fund for capital replacement. They were used for other recreation centers that have been running deficits, and why now the restaurant has been closed when it's near $95,000, which is 0.004% of the total municipal budget. So I have some questions as to why those items have been removed from the budget. And that's all I wish to say at the moment.
Concerns about the Mackenzie Avenue upgrade, a plan from McGill Road to Harrow Road. These are my questions. They pertain to bicycle paths, the traffic circle, and Sinclair Hill. Bicycle paths. Given that there is space for bicycle paths, do the designers of this upgrade realize that cyclists prefer bicycle paths to bicycle lanes? By bicycle lanes, I mean strips on the side of the road where cyclists are separated from cars, trucks, and buses by a white line on the road and hills. By paths, I mean paths that are some distance from the road and tend to be narrow and sometimes meandering from trees and more people to the road. What do the existing cyclists, some of whom cycle on the road and others what do they think? What are their views? Have they been concerned? Could bicycle paths not be integrated into pedestrian paths, as has been done in many other cities? Space permitting, are bicycle paths not considerably less costly than bicycle lanes? specifications and the rules. Bicycle paths are on the side of the road. May I ask why the more costly, less desirable solution was being selected? On traffic circles, how does the cost of a traffic circle compare with the cost of having three left-turn lanes to the existing intersection, which is currently controlled by traffic lights that control not only the flow of vehicles, but control the flow of pedestrians as well? More important, which approach can safely handle more pedestrian traffic without backing up vehicle traffic? Is this, or will this ever be an issue? What might be an issue? Where are the studies that back this up? While traffic circles can be very effective, in some cases, it would seem to me that placing pedestrian crosswalks on every spoke of the traffic circle would warrant its effectiveness. Where is the evidence that supports a traffic circle in a location brought into a pile of bicycles? And there we go. Some other place we can use as well, so that is working regularly. Working right there, so it's going to work right there. If there isn't, we'll have to get it. Do we know how bicycles will cope with the traffic circle? What evidence do we have that cyclists will do what designers would like them to do? Will cyclists be put at risk or be tempted to put themselves at risk by circling around them? And then Sinclair Hill, probably the most important. Understands the Sinclair upgrade has yet to be designed. At least that's what we're told in the scan game. Being the main entrance to Catwood Bay, Sinclair Hill will impact our community enormously. It's the gateway. So if this project is going to blow the budget, at least that's a mature plan. Catwood Bay residents must have into the design.
I'd like to review is to go on his anti-bullying
parking right here on the same stretch, but this is not factored in. The planning was all done before this, and the planning goes only from the view. On the website it says it's from the view arrow, and we heard, yes, it will go down over the view, but there's no point. That piece of approach is what I'm talking about. It's just not good enough. Of our physical past. You don't guys can spend a lot of money on heritage, and you shouldn't. But you should keep it in your minds at this point as before. We should be able to remember, because there's physical reminders of the history of our country. Thank you very much for listening to me, and good luck with your deliberations. You can save $2.5 million by scratching. Thank you. survey that we've done. It started in 2003. It's one of the best methods of getting community input, best methods of public engagement, because it's a scientifically valid survey with random sample. This year, was done in January. Sample was 2,100 households. Response rate at 29% was 607. The best in four tries, which is always very encouraging to us. The margin of error is 95%. We call it a confidence interval, plus or minus 4% of the time. What that really means is if you have an answer to a question that is, say, 90 to 10, then you take your 4% and put it either side of that 90, which means your response, you're pretty certain of the result between 86 and 94%. So you might make a decision based on that. Was a 50-50 response, then you might not want to make a life-threatening decision because it could be 46 to 54%. So that's what the confidence and margin of error is all about. Was independent review, but I will go to the always get that independent review to make sure results are appropriate. The full report will be available for the community members and council. So this is just a taste of the survey. I should mention that Monica, Harris, Sorry, folks that's put this all together. We're very lucky to have this capacity that was probably on some of the sides of the desk. Save ourselves thousands of dollars to sell all the firms that's going to be doing some things. First of all, quality of life. When I was in school, 92% was a pretty good mark. I don't think nowadays, but quality of life was ranked 92%, so it was a good, very good quality of life. A little bit down from 95 after 2009, but it's still a pretty good mark. I wonder if perhaps the economy was a reason for that. Then I looked at 2003, the economy was pretty good, it was only 87%, but I'm not sure why. Saanich is a place.
is that I think the municipality has been going in that great direction, very consistent. Following through that, which I should say, again, there's not a lot of money that's on the list of people that do, so that's all. It should say that we have a lot of money, which we have a great choice. The next slide is, you know, always an interesting one on taxation. Again, a lot of consistency here. This really lets us know if citizens would like to say tax increase or tax decrease. We're talking about substantial increases in taxes. Or say stay at the same level, reduce the level of municipal services. And if you look at through the years, it's been very consistent. Saanich taxpayers have been enjoying a tremendous result. Like the same level of taxes or the same or reduced level of municipal services. And that's exactly what the council did. In the last 4 years, with budget reductions, areas were actually reducing the amount of municipal services redirecting money to infrastructure programs and trying to reduce services within the waste department. One significant change, though, if you look at it from 2003 to 2012, we seem to have a growing number of people that will pay higher taxes within the municipal services, 7.2%. Facilities, $1, which is awesome. Not sure what's going on with environmental protection enhancement. Sometimes you see with the environmental side, it drops in the public's radar. I'm sure. Also interesting, a little less on sidewalks from where they were in 2009. My guess is there was such a issue around sidewalks in 2009. And finally, a reduction in the arts. That's a very significant $4.11 down to $255 in 2003. And it could very well be because of the city. So I believe there's no answer.
surveys are obviously valuable. Feedback for council. I was curious what we do with them in 3 years. What role does it play in forming that process?
Sit down, sit down, and share this with you.
is probably not what we get. So I'm wondering, are we really looking at these companies and questioning them? Is there an alternative permit? We are needing that respect and possibly a little bit of just a place to help with a really powerful one for the regular season. Such that we can make a computer system. My historical practice has been in my own lab. I've been around one time last year for 3 to 5 years. It's been a few hundred thousand dollars to buy some safety stock. And that seizure is going to be done and replace the whole thing. It's a huge undertaking in that year to staff up for it. So it's a very disruptive thing to do. Decide that purchasing a Dell unit at this point works and fits well for the opportunity. The person is working hard on the applications. It seems now the time for the opportunity software is needed to run. So it's much more flexible. Thank you.
audited it.
Okay, debt management, page 27.
Just very briefly, debt management, council's policy is to budget for the debt guideline, which is approximately 7% of 7% of revenue, which equates to just over $5 million in debt service budget. That budget increases as we increase each year, so that some free lights was developed and quite some light programs in the way in which was meant to reflect the average of 7% was the average debt service as a percentage of revenue. So to run that path since that that translates to 55 million dollars in debt.
Apparently the market is sweeter for 7-year term rather than 10-year right now. Okay, Councilor Vera.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I mentioned your comment is relates to one of my questions, which is most of our borrowing is around 10 years. Is that better? I know it's another way of it, primarily 15 years. I'm just trying to get a sense of as we manage our low interest rates for a number of years. We continue to see our interest payments continue to decline as we retire older debt. Is that a fair assumption? Do we, based on your borrowing, is there probably less more towards the right time? I mean, that would be, maybe in general, to try to towards that. One of the benefits of this borrowing economy is that money tends to be expensive and the gold chain is pay as long as pay, but it's still less expensive than it used to be. My question was, I had another one about CMHC, which you covered, thank you very much. Always a pleasant surprise to see that I'm sure we weren't anticipating. I think the comment about 6.1 million annual debt servicing costs were about 50 million in total. You're talking about guideline or target, because I've noticed that we're at 4.1 million this year,
sounded like good news, though. The third paragraph, the swings went up well within the guideline of maximum 7%. And as I see it, 6.1 per day, that servicing cost would be 55.
So you missed me with the 53.
No, you're right. I was looking at last year's.
That was my only question.
About two million.
Could be more.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, Council. Guests. Present the Parks and Recreation 2012 budget this evening, and with me is our manager of parks. The Parks and Recreation Department has three main divisions, being parks, recreation services area, and the golf course. Overall, going into 2012, we're looking at a nominal increase of just over 1% for the entire department. That this year is driven primarily by the closure of the central office. Typically, SCP will close for about 2 weeks for their maintenance period. This year, 12 weeks as a facility. We show an FTE reduction this year that basically stems from three areas. Golf course restructuring, the Skylight replacement at SCP and shutdown that will take place, and 1% reduction scenario within the recreation division. So with the SCP aspect, obviously, the FTE will revert again up. Bit of talk this evening about the carbon numbers. We aren't exempt, obviously, with major facilities in operation. We've seen an increase that is a combination of footprint PPs or an increase on the ground. Both the first full complete year of operation that's been had, as well as 6 months of operation for the Art Center in Cedar Hill. In speaking with the sustainability coordinator, he has indicated, as I think you've heard, that there was a spike in utility usage in the first 6 months of the year. He reports that's within all of the facilities in Saanich, and I think it's been his colleagues across the region. Other folks will talk about that as well. He's sort of poked around and tried to find out what the rationale is behind that. Overwhelming with just overall temperature costs or temperature rates. In looking at highlights from 2011, that's part of the natural areas focus within the Parks Division. We've got very successful pulling together program. We've got over 20 groups operating in 30 sites that have been a great assistance in the invasive species issue. As was identified in the 2011 strategic plan, we've had environmental scientists installed in a couple of the parks, Douglas and Baxter. And the opening of the Art Center in Cedar Hill was obviously a great success, to the extent that we've actually had to pull back on the orientations we've been doing with the ceramic studios because of the material capacity. So hindsight is great and helpful. That's what we have. So as you know, certainly looking for the early childhood strategy was completed, and in speaking with some people who wrote that initiative, our manager of community services, he's indicating that certainly one of the great benefits of that process has been the channels that have opened up and the group collaboration amongst community service providers in the early childhood area. And I think that's ultimately responsible for better services overall. Substantial completion of the Parks Recreation and Culture Master Plan, which has some delays, but we hope to have it passed in the spring. Gordon Head saw the installation of an ultraviolet purification system in the pool, and that certainly helped to reduce the need for gas chlorine, which also at the golf course, we engaged in a process with the neighbors, and this was led by Gary Kelly and Smith, with regards to Aaron Balls leaving the southwest side of the golf course. And we've done some tree planting and tee box changes. So we're happy to be able to engage with that. Moving into 2012, some three key challenges. staff in both the Recreation and Parks Division have worked hard to minimize the impact of the annual budget reduction scenarios we've been involved with in the last little while. The 1% reduction in recreation that I mentioned a little bit earlier on is anticipated to come from attrition. We, this may end up having some impact in terms of the scope of the programs that we offer. It may have some bit of delays on day-to-day maintenance or impact on day-to-day maintenance. There's a number of shifts where we have level coverage where we have to move away from replacing one or folks who may be out there if they're away on the holidays or they're off on sick leave, so they may be out there. In the parks area, there hasn't been a formal 1% reduction. I think that's a recognition of the fact that it's had an inventory. We still are in a net position, a net loss position, if you will, of having significantly increased workload in the parks as a result of the acquisitions. And typically, when we were looking at a 1% reduction there, that was going to manifest itself through short seasonal work seasons and the possibility of reduced movement cycles in the sales of the parks. The cul-de-sacs right now are a three-day rotation. Three times in the season. Twice within the season. And in parks, I believe right now we're on 14-day cycle. Parks are looking at the overall core budget for 2012, approximately for 2011, now approximately one-third of the overage that we experienced was associated with the golf course, with the balance stemming from basically increased operating costs. So we'll certainly continue addressing those costs as prior to the markets. Looking at some of the specific areas on page 52, the Parks Division is staying relatively static with a very minor increase of 0.6%. Cedar Hill Recreation Center and the Arts Center at Cedar Hill has increased as a result of an additional 6 months of operation in this expanded facility. And certainly the use of the new space continues to grow, and partnerships similar to the Arts Caliber Academy preschool that we have running there and the partnership with the Arts Council of Greater Victoria are very positive and certainly increasing opportunities in that area throughout the year. Gordon Head Rec Center is staying static through the next year. It's completed its first full year of operations in expanded space. We're hoping certainly that a full year of operation with the UV system and fine-tuning the trial domestic hot water solar system here will realize some additional savings and then potentially roll that solar Perks actually shows a bit of a decrease in net costs, and that's primarily due to strong revenue and projected revenue both from the arena and the field house. Saanich Commonwealth Place, we're looking at about $100,000 in a net cost increase due to the net reduced revenue from the toll associated with the Skyline replacement. Community services stays relatively static, a small 1% increase had a sort of a pleasant problem in a couple of the youth centers that community services are responsible for. It's requiring some additional staffing as well as the teenagers attending there. And in terms of the golf course, obviously sustainability is going to be a focus. I think some of the figures on page 57 will actually
closed once a year for seasonal, once a year maintenance. The pool's closed. What is that norm? What is it? How long is it normally closed, and how long are we closing it for this replacement?
We normally close for 2 weeks at the most, and we're closed for a total of 12 weeks.
Just a question on those 12 weeks. I know I raised it once, and the comment was, we just don't do that.
Thank you.
that's comfortable for one person isn't always comfortable for the next person. So you can turn it down a couple of notches for you.
No, I'm still my next question is probably more for Mr. Murray. As I mentioned, I think the Art Center can have this code and have this service. One of the things I get asked is that is, I would like to be able to get figures of what the actual cost of the use was. And that includes, of course, operating costs, but it also includes municipal operating costs. I want to be in New York, and I'm quite willing to defend to our taxpayers that where they're getting a very good value for their money. But I would like to be able to see those kinds of costs, and I can't at present time. And is there going to be an opportunity for that to come forward?
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure if I can understand the extent of the
Well, the most simply, I'd like to know as I can. This is not much all in costing per year. I would like to be able to do the same thing. So this is much all in the same kinds of costs that are costing us for this given year. Otherwise, it's an incomplete number. It doesn't really give me
anything. Mr. Chairman, as I said, it's certainly something.
Maybe I can speak to you about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a few comments. We talked about our email about this before, about the water situation with recommends and fountains. I don't see anything here. I guess it's all recommends and fountains. About the fountain situation.
I think, Chair, page 81, under the recreation facilities capital, there's funding identified for that, so that transition is here.
Okay. Sorry, I missed it.
It's okay.
That leads me, thank you. Now, we were talking about energy efficiencies and that. Is the hot water in the showers necessary? Is that not solar power, or is that
I know that there was a study done a couple of years ago that looked at that solar had a large solar panel distribution both in Oregon and in SUV, and I believe that all that took place is the smaller trial system.
Yes,
Facebook and Twitter are certainly available to whether it's part
been starting to do that.
Right. So, having the same amount of people all year long sometimes is better than more at certain times.
Okay. The other thing you didn't mention, perhaps you didn't miss it, was, of course, pesticide free. Species.
Yeah, on the pesticide free policy as well as the pesticide bylaw allows for the use of invasive species. It's always the last resort. Significant shift in the increased their reliance on mulching. That's had a good impact. So, really, it's pulling together the final.
Incentives to get people in the door in January in terms of trying out recreation services, and I wonder what kind of impact that has on numbers.
Through the chair, for that particular program, I think we had about 1,300 people take advantage of it, and there were about 600 folks that we hadn't seen before, so that was pretty good as well.
Do we know how many of those folks end up being returning users?
I don't have those specific numbers. I would think that it's just like anything else.
Thank you. My other question is, it's been touched on quite a bit, and that's about, I was thinking in particular about some of the upgrades we could work ahead to take advantage of. I was going to ask about that. You addressed that this evening. My question, I think, my suggestion in general, is that it's clear that there's some interest in how facilities can be upgraded before we go to wholesale plant replacement in order to capture some of the existing energies that are currently used, say, to heat water or create ice, and how we position to take better advantage of those. So I know this is an area that Mr. Wilson is keenly interested in, so I'm wondering if you might be able to see maybe not call it a strategy, but some possible options to help us mitigate some of our additional energy costs with some energy consumption savings. That makes sense.
Thank you. situations you'll have radiant heaters up in the stands. I think that you're correct in the old. Didn't recover the full cost. Minor hockey's idea, actually. I don't think they were handing the coin.
The other facility, which is the subsidy.
Chair, I think in terms of the high performance fund and the $330,000 that we're supposed to continue to get until 2015, based on the latest figures, I know it says 2013, it's either, I think it's 2013 or 2014, we're in negotiations with the high performance users, as well as trying to have some serious dialogue. To see if there's any opportunity for additional funding there and send to the letter to both parties in the same response initially. I'm not sure if the advance of the, as we get closer to the Summer Olympics, and where there's a very clear indication that the support of high performance athlete at SCP is producing very clear results in terms of the athletes and the point. I'm not sure whether that will have any. One of the other constraints that we have within the operating agreement is the terminology that restricts us from any increases to high performance user beyond the CPI. And it also indicates that the state has one of the lowest across the country. We are the lowest across the country. And so we've had some of those discussions with the high performance users. Obviously, there is a huge appetite on their part to see that change. By opening up that agreement to certain athletes over there, especially in the province, that would be a good thing.
So will that be in the discussions?
Through the chair, I think the initial thought of opening that agreement up was to try and get at that one clause and restrict it. I think we have sort of come to terms with the number of hours that high performance users need in the facility to reach their particular goals, and trying to balance that off with the needs of the recreation goals. So at this time, we haven't been looking at trying to make both of those make a little bit of cost and cost reduction with high performance. certainly there are some questions within the master plan process with regards to participation. Whether they, I need to go back and look to see if they create specific as part of the childhood obesity study that community services did last year, one of the offshoots of that has been a program that started up in the school district 63 to provide some after school programs for, I guess, more of the latchkey students.
question. We're talking about the fees, correct?
Yeah.
Yes.